Good morning, everybody. I hope you hear me well. My name is Chiara Fanzoni. I am professor at Politecnico di Milano. I'm extremely privileged to be here today with three exceptional speakers. So as part of this year course in patents and IP management, the course that we offer to the students of Politecnico di Milano, we wanted to discuss the topics, the incredibly important topic of generative AI and the way in which they stretch the current IP system. Clearly, artificial intelligence is incredibly pervasive, and especially it has shown that it has an enormous capacity to generate new content, create music, images, but also invent, write code, and a lot of the activities that traditionally were done by humans. And clearly, these applications have just started to do these activities, but we can just think that they will do more and more in the future. And so clearly, all of these issues have put the current system under incredible stretch. And I think they have raised enormous questions, including, should we provide algorithms with the ability to be named for what they have created, for example, give them copyrights or the inventorship of patents. On the other hand, they have posed practical challenges. For example, when we are training an algorithm, are we free to use, for example, copyrighted material that has been shared publicly, like, for example, the blogs or the news? Or can people be held liable if they're algorithms are accidentally copying parts of proprietary material that is out there? They have also raised new concerns because clearly AI has made possible a lot of applications, some of which have questionable uses. For example, what if your algorithm creates a tool that in the end enables de facto discrimination by gender, ethnicity, or sexual preferences, political orientations? Could you be held liable? Can you tackle that in some way? Or again, what is the profile of liability for everything that relates to the algorithm that you have perhaps purchased, but not created necessarily? So clearly, it is important to say that some of these questions will not have an answer, a final answer anytime soon. There is a big debate going on, and this is also why we have three exceptional speakers today with me. I'm happy to say hi to them. I'll present them in a minute. They are Jean-Marc Del Torn, Domenico Golzio, and Andrea Perronace. So without taking any more time, I wish to introduce our first speaker today, who is going to be Jean-Marc Del Torn. Or forget me, before we do so, I need to alert you of the fact that we are recording the meeting. And so we assume that you are okay with this since the recording is now in place. Okay, so Jean-Marc. Jean-Marc is professor at the Center for International Intellectual Property Studies, CIP, in Strasbourg. And he has an exceptional profile because he has a master in law, but he also has two PhDs, one in theoretical physics and one in law. So extremely, extremely broad training. And he has always focused on the interplay between AI and privacy. In the early stages of his career, he has also worked for more than 15 years at the European Patent Office, where he has been an examiner, especially for inventions in the ICT sector. And more recently, he is now working as a professor, but he's also a member of the Impact of Technology Expert Group of the European Observatory on Infringement of Intellectual Property Rights within the European Union Intellectual Property Office. At CIP, Jean-Marc also studies the relationship between engineering, digital technology, privacy, intellectual property, has authored many publications. He is a colleague in academia. So Jean-Marc, please.
Right. Thanks so much, Chiara, for the kind invitation and good words. I'll try and first share my presentation, if you don't mind. There you go. should appear very, very soon. Let me know when it's on. Is it there already? Yeah, okay, super, fantastic. So I'm starting my clock, 15 minutes, a very short time to cover a very, very broad topic. It's very topical, of course. We all speak about generative AI now. It's no need to introduce what machine learning is, because some of you are engineers, so you know about the field. I'll dive into something that seems very, very actual, very modern, but actually is quite present in the ecosystem of creativity for many years. Now, you see here, it's an extract from a journal of luxury and fashions from the 18th century that inspired maybe Mozart for some of his creation. And it's essentially an algorithmic way of creating music. So the interplay between algorithms, recipes, technologies such as mathematics and randomness and creativity have been there for a while. Of course, we speak about something quite different now. It's a landslide in the field of creativity. It's ChatGPT, Midjourney, Stable Diffusion, many, many different tools that can produce different kinds of artifacts from text to images and music, and that create havoc in the ecosystem of creativity and creators. You see here the reaction of an artist on Twitter or X now, saying that a new AI image generator appears to be capable of making art that looks 100% human-made. As an artist, that person is extremely concerned, and maybe he or she should be, because you see that in this other example, AI produced, or at least works that have been created using AI, have been competing with human beings and even won at certain fairs in Colorado in that particular example. So the question is this fair? Should we ban altogether all those AI productions, or can we protect them, and by which mechanism? Is copyright the right way? What to do with those creations? So before going further in the topic, I think it's a good idea to give you a sort of a very superficial but useful maybe introduction to copyright for those of you who are not familiar with it. What is copyright? What is it about? Essentially, it's a mechanism that attempts to encourage artistic creation. And to do so, it makes it very, very easy for all of us to be authors. What you have to do is essentially take anything, a pen or an instrument or pretty much any other tool, and produce an object that is a reflection of your personality. There's no need, as in patents or trademarks, to go in front of an administration and register your work. The simple fact of creating that object, producing it in a tangible way, assigns you a copyright, provided certain conditions are met. There's a limited property right, 70 years after your death, so it's quite a long time indeed, and it protects the expression of the idea, not the idea itself. It's a very, very important concept to have in mind. It pervades all fields of IP. Ideas are not protectable as such. It's the expression, the tangible expression of these ideas, that is the locus of the expression. There's a bit of a dichotomy between the idea and expression. No copyright for the idea. And maybe under certain conditions, we'll see that in a second, a possibility of protecting, being granted an exclusive right on the expression of this idea. An important point to raise for the subject today is the fact that copyright doesn't care at all about the tool you use to create an object, whether it's a pen, a brush, a lithography, a saw in a musical saw example, or any kind of more technologically inclined object, such as a camera or a computer. We don't care, essentially. It doesn't really matter. What it matters, in fact, is not the fact that you register it, as I mentioned before, not the substrate, literature, music, drama, photography, or whatsoever, not even the merit. We don't really care if it's a beautiful piece, or if it took you a long time or not. It doesn't really matter. In fact, that was actually highlighted in a series of decisions in the US a long time ago. Now, just want to raise it because it's quite interesting to see the reason why. The absence of consideration regarding the style of creative expression the appeal, the mode of expression, the intention of the artist are the core, really consubstantial of the copyright system. And quoting a very very well-known decision from more than a century ago in the US, the judges said that it would be a dangerous undertaking for persons trained only to the law to constitute themselves as final judges of the worth of pictorial illustrations outside of the narrowest and most obvious limits. I mean, the judges are not a good person to judge about the aesthetic value of an object, and therefore we leave it aside. We don't care. It's not for us to judge whether there is a necessity of merit. So no merit and no consideration about the tool, but what is required for copyright protection is essentially two things that are the cornerstone of the system: the presence of a work and a certain threshold of originality. So a work, what do we mean by that? I'll come back to Europe now to quote a few decisions from the European Court of Justice. What is a work? Well, something that has a certain kind of objective character. For example, a literary, a pictorial, or a cinematographic work are considered a tangible expression that everybody would agree on. On the opposite, the taste of the taste you feel essentially as an individual about a particular sensation is a cognitive property that is very close to you, but not necessarily equal for all other people. So it has a subjective character, and for that reason, we can't really protect the taste using copyright. Maybe other mechanism, but not this one. So an objective form of expression, that's essentially the notion of a work. And the second really important notion that we need to establish now is the fact that a work has to be original. So this is really the cornerstone of the system. And what do we mean by that notion of originality? Well, the case law now established in a series of decisions, in particular in Europe and elsewhere in the world, that it equates to the fact that it should be the author's own intellectual creation. You should have produced that object, but also it should reflect your personality, your who you are as a person. How do we do that? By allowing to make free and creative choices. This notion of, in a sense, embedding those free and creative choices in the output, in the work, that objective, tangible object that you produce, is really the centerpiece of the copyright system. So provided you have those two things, essentially you have a copyright, you're an author, right? The issue here, and that we're going to talk about now in the remaining time, is whether that presence of an artificial intelligence generative tool changes the deal. Can there be creative choices if you have a trained neural network model, for example, a transformer, or any other kind of a neural network between you as a user that may input, for example, a prompt or define certain properties of the system, and the output, the work, or maybe just a creation. The question we need to ask really ourselves is about that. And luckily enough, now we dive back from the ethereal sphere of abstraction to the reality of administrations, because that question has been really asked to the courts, I mean, at least the administration in the US, and now in Europe, several cases have, in a sense, had to evaluate what we meant by that threshold of originality, when indeed there is an intermediary in between a machine learning system. In that particular case that was put to the scrutiny of the US Copyright Office, Krishna Kashtanova is an author, she's a writer. And she wrote a book, Zarya of the Dawn. It's a story, I pass the detail, but she used Midjourney to illustrate the book, to create images that would, in a sense, pave or be allow her to make a comics out of this book. And to do so, she inputted elements of the text that were deemed original. It's her own creation, she's the writer, but she inputted this text into the Midjourney system to produce those images that you see, right? Zarya of the Dawn now is a comics, it's not just a text anymore. Can this object, the combined version of text and visuals, be protected by copyright? Well, in this case, the US Copyright Office only granted partial copyright to Mrs. Castanova by saying indeed that the process by which a Midjourney user obtains a good enough image through the tool is not the same as that of a human artist. The initial prompt by a user generates several different images and the person chooses from a choice of all four outputs is not enough to manifest your free and creative choices. It's not, in a sense, there's not room enough to express your freedom of expression, if you will. So that's a bit of an interesting case, because here you see that Chris Castanova has not been denied fully copyright. She's only assigned that copyright where indeed she could prove she did make those free and creative choices, essentially the text, but denied copyright on the other portion, where indeed she essentially was a user of a Midjourney system that left her very, very limited level of creativity in terms of free and creative choices. Quite of a balanced statement. And essentially that's the idea. So the user cannot anticipate what the output of each action will be. Kristina Kashinova could not anticipate the output of her prompt, but she could just pick the output from a limited selection. Not good enough. So Midjourney images did not contain a high enough level of human involvement to be protectable by copyright. That seems relatively fair, even though Kristina Castanova mentioned that she was playing with Photoshop afterwards, after the fact, and modifying a little bit the images. But you see here the modification is not substantial and not important enough to justify a copyright involvement. So no copyright on the images. Several other cases that will pass very quickly on. One I mentioned here because we're going to talk about Steven Teller in a moment with the case of Dabus. Is that the same person originating the two affairs? Here it's a recent entrance to paradise. In that particular case, Mr. Teller is trying to push the system a little bit to provoke sort of a debate about the fact that a machine could or could not be an author. Well, the answer is super simple, as in the patent system. No, the answer is no. Only human beings can be author. It's part of the exclusive right granted to human beings, not to machines. So there's no need to try that further. The fact that you can claim that the system autonomously generated a work such as this one, which could be debated in essence. I'm not exactly sure that notion of autonomy is fully realized here, but the conclusion is that essentially there should be a human in the loop to manifest those free creative choices, at least one. In Europe, actually, and I pass by the various guidelines now stated by the US Copyright Office, just to dive back in the few cases in Europe that I found quite interesting, because they give us a sort of a more local approach to how we consider originality for AI-generated outputs. It's a very recent Czech Republic cases, and here again, an object that was created using a prompt. And the output, essentially you see here the prompt, create a visual representation of two parties signing a business contract in a formal setting, such as a meeting room or an office or a law firm in Prague, just show the hands. Is that enough that, in sense, whichever image that could be generated by that particular prompt would be granted copyright? The court said no, in a sense, because there's no control on the output. The notion that the fact there is a gap between the intention of the prompt generator, the person who drafts the prompt, and the output produced through the intermediation of that algorithmic system creates sort of a divide. It is sort of a filter that breaks the causality link between the intention of the artist and the control over the output, or simply the manifestation of his or her creative choices. No copyright in the Czech Republic. In Italy, there was a case in front of the Supreme Court where there was not much AI in play here, just a fractal tool, but it gives us a sort of a balanced statement that I found quite interesting to conclude with soon, is that the fact that according to the Supreme Court of Italy, the fact that you use an AI system does not as such deny the possibility that you may be granted copyright. It's not because you use a tool. Remember, we don't care about how you made it. What's important is that you had essentially enough freedom, degrees of freedom, we would say as engineers, on the output so that you can manifest your personality. So simply using a tool just like generative AI is not enough to manifest those choices, but the reality is a bit more complicated indeed. Again, putting a very simplified pipeline of AI from training data to essentially the output here, there can be many places where value is distributed and also choices. Just to brush on that topic, which I find very important, that there are many cases at the moment in the US and soon in Europe also, popping up on the fact that the machine learning system is being trained on data and sometimes memorizes or reproduces elements that are deemed original. Here in the output, you see this Shutterstock fingerprint that's appearing that demonstrates indeed that the model has essentially memorized certain elements of the sources. It's important because in the case of these images, like Thanos here representing those images, there's almost a strict copy from the output, and copyright, you know, the name implies it, protects against copying. So very, very large models, the large language models we used to playing with now, have the capability, and sometimes even when whatever we try to prevent that from, doesn't really matter, that memorize certain element of the sources and tend to reproduce them at the end. It's quite dangerous here because you see here there's a direct infringement on copyright in those cases. So it opens the gate to many, many different litigations. We can try to find options, but they're very technically difficult at the moment. So it's a very, very active field for, in a sense, for us lawyers and also engineers to try to find the right balance between protecting the sources, the creators, the rights holders on the data, but also preventing from stifling creativity, because indeed a new tool is often the locus of new fields of creation, and we want to encourage that as well. That's a bit of a balance we need to work on. I'll finish on that slide just to give you a hint about the complexity of the system, and maybe we'll talk about that later in the questions. I mentioned the Italian case. I find it quite interesting because it shows that indeed it's not because you have AI in the loop that there's no human involvement elsewhere below the iceberg, below the level of the sea, things you don't see happening. From original work, the selection of those work, from the way you manipulate those works through an architecture, a training system using a utility function, for example, or even the fact that you select and reiterate, modify in post-production the works you're producing using AI, all of these could be potentially the locus of a creative act. So that makes it a very interesting and intricate, in a sense, landscape. And well, I hope we'll talk about that more in the questions in a moment. Thank you so much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Jean-Marc. I think it's been extremely interesting. I'm sure that a lot of people will already have questions. And I just want to remark that we will have question and answers at the end. So in case you have questions, feel free to raise your virtual hand or also type your question in the chat, and we'll get back to that in a few minutes. Now, before we do so, I would like to introduce the second speaker. And the second speaker is Domenico Gozio. Domenico holds a degree in physics, and after working for several years as an electronic engineer in the telecommunications and automotive and aerospace industries, many years ago, he joined the European Patent Office as a patent examiner with a focus on the field of ICT. And since then, he has spent his entire career at the European Patent Office, where he has served as the director of a search and examination unit. And he has led the directorate developing tools for prior art search and also patent information. He now conducts research on various aspects of IPRs, including the relationship between patents and innovation, patent information, international patent portfolios, and comparisons between the different patent systems. So, Domenico, please.
Okay, thank you. thank you, Chiara. Thank you for the invitation, and I hope to be at the same level of performance of my friend Jean-Marc and Andrea. I'll try to share here my screen. Let me know if... if you get, can you see the presentation? Can you see the presentation?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, we do.
Yeah, because you have to tell me, because I don't see you when my presentation is on. Okay, well, I will focus on patentability of biometrics and new artificial intelligence acts. But before starting, I would like to give a couple of definitions. So in the daily life, at least myself, but I think a lot of us, we use interchangeably complexity and complication. In reality, I think these two definitions are a little bit different. And complexity refers to something inherent in the nature of an object or system. And I took here the as an example, okay, of course, the topic of today. So here is a slide of Jean-Marc, so here's the copyright. Here you can see an AI-based system, and then you can see the complexity, because there are so many elements, and also in one of the last slides Jean-Marc just presented, you could see how complex can be internally AI system, generative system, as he presented. Complication is more something we add from external extraneous elements to a system. And this applies to the AI system. For instance, patentability, inventorship, ownership. Andrea will deal more in detail about that. Just now, a couple of months ago, and even a few days ago, there was the publication of the EU Artificial Intelligence Act, which add some complication in dealing, using, and producing artificial intelligence system. Also, we have the GDPR, so the General Data Protection Regulation, is a little bit older now, but still active, and will act also in parallel to the EU AI Act. And also, we should consider also other system, other complication coming from other entity. For instance, Politecnico Milano has a lot of patents, between one third, one half of the patent from Politecnico Milano are also extended to US. So then you have also to check what is happening there. And in fact, also US is working on their own Artificial Intelligence Act. So in December, the president of the White House published what is called an executive order in order to build a law about the regulation about artificial intelligence. Just 2 days ago, I received the comments from National Institute of Standard and Technology from US commenting on this, and the idea is when you design a new system, then you have to take into consideration all this complication when, of course, deals with artificial intelligence. And without spoiling what is going to be presented by Andrea, so the European Patent Convention as a list of exclusion of entity or activity which cannot be patentable. So and this is what is highlighted here in yellow, and then you recognize all this is what is behind or is part of the artificial intelligence. Of course, you can do, you cannot patent this as such, but implementation with a technical effect of this is patentable. But also, the European Patent Convention, which has been designed 50 years ago, so last year was the 50th anniversary of the European Patent Convention. Also, there are a list of exceptions, so of invention, so technically we could consider invention, but because of reason of order public or morality, this invention cannot be patented. And also in yellow, the last paragraph, there are also method treatment of human therapeutical methods, etc. So all this, which is, as you know, implemented or could be implemented with artificial intelligence, all this are considered exception and cannot be patented. But I move now to the EU Artificial Intelligence Act, approved last March, so 1 month and a half ago. Already there was a corrigendum a couple of weeks ago. You, I guess the presentation will be distributed, and then you can click on the hyperlink and then get this document. By the way, these documents are very heavy. The corrigendum is something like 450 pages. Still has to be entered into force because it has to be published on the official journal of the European Union. It was expected last week, I think, but okay, it will happen soon. And there are a period of 6 to 36 months to be implemented, depending also on the national endorsement, etc. As probably you have heard, this is the world's first ever legal framework on artificial intelligence. But as I said, be careful, because if you design a system, okay, in this global market, you have also to take care of what is happening in other countries, for instance, the US, I just mentioned. And the main objective of the EU Artificial Intelligence Act is to prevent the risk, the ethical risk arising from AI system, and more specifically on the, their use. The second objective, which is, okay, this is what is written there, is to avoid a long list of a further complication or complicated law on this system, so to have a regulation which is easy to apply, and the main issue is not to block the development, the technology, because by the way, as you know, there are some criticism saying EU is regulating while US is developing, and other countries maybe are copying, and we are just regulating. So the idea is indeed to help the inventor or the companies, etc., to produce, put in place, deploy system which are acceptable considering the fundamental rights of the European Union. So this document, this act, categorized the artificial intelligence system according to the risk profile we will see in a moment. But the EU Artificial Intelligence Act doesn't give any specific provision concerning IPRs, patent, etc. So And this is something we will have to take care. So there are four main categories of risk level. So there are unacceptable risk. So are the system which violate the EU values and fundamental ethical rights, like dignity, right to life, integrity of the person, belonging to minorities, etc. Then there are a second category called high risk AI system, and basically our system which can, if misused, can affect negatively health, safety, the people, fundamental rights, or the environment. And and clearly, this is the probably the gray category where a lot of existing systems are already there, and then we have to take care when we use or when we design a future system. Then there are systems, the third category, which is called the limited risk. And in this category, there are the system where there is a risk of manipulation or deceit. And for instance, the generative AI system is belonging to this category, but we will see this in more detail later. And in the end, there are a fourth level called the minimal risk, for instance, a spam filter or a system where there are no real restriction or mandatory obligation. So here I try to depict here in this picture the four level. They correspond to article of the EU AI Act. So in Article 5, there are the what are called the unacceptable risk. So system fall in this category are prohibited. So you cannot put in the market, you cannot use. And don't forget that the EU AI Act is territorial. So even if the system comes from, let's say, US, the fact is used in Europe, will fall under this Article 5 and has to be prohibited. So it doesn't matter who is the manufacturer. The point here is the territory where is used. And here there are the general, the social scoring, facial recognition, dark pattern AI, manipulation. So these are just examples. Then there are what are called the high risk, like a system we can already use, like in education, in employment, justice, immigration, for law enforcement. So, okay, I just passed recently, it was in US, I just passed all this passport in Europe, also passport identification. All this system are system considered high risk because can be, if not properly supervised, humanly supervised, etc., can be abused. And so they require a conformity assessment in the design deployment, and then I will mention this later. Then there are the system with a limited risk, chatbots, deepfakes, emotion recognition system. And in this case, what is requested is the system shall tell you what are they are doing. So what is called transparency of obligation. So the system should tell you, okay, well, what I'm telling you, the way I talking to you, I'm not a person, I'm a robot, I'm a computer, and I'm based on information I take from a database, etc. And finally, there are minimal risk where there is no current specification, but is of we hope there will be a kind of code of conduct and companies and will adopt a system to make clear what the system is doing, etc. So there are here, okay, well, more example. There are, I mentioned the 8 categories of the unacceptable risk, the prohibited AI system, and I just highlighted here the biometric categorization of person based on sensitive characteristics, and I'm not going to talk all about this because I think I'm already gone on my time. I will switch to I risk system. So those are systems, as I already mentioned, using law enforcement, as I said, passport control or migration, asylum, border control management, etc. Those systems are allowable, but if misused, could be misused, of course, and you have to pay attention in designing and deploying. The AI Act has plenty of definition. There is Article 3, is very long with a lot of definition, and of course it gives a definition of AI system, which is basically the definition of OECD definition, which is currently using in Europe, basically. And I just using a simple keyword search, I put here the using ESPASnet, you can do by yourself. So just to give you the idea of the number of patent family, which could fall in this definition. So basically, we have 1 million patent family related to AI system. And starting from this definition, just using the biometric elements like face, eye, movement, body shape, voice, etc., all this what highlighted here in red, again, you will find something like 500,000 patent family, which potentially could fall in the high risk or the prohibited system. And okay, always with ESPASnet, a very quick search. I specialized the search checking or searching for race or ethnicity, and then you can see already something 3,000 patent publication dealing with this. I didn't want to go in more detail for politically correct reason, but you can try with ethnicity as with simple search, and you can find, you will be surprised what is already patented or at least published as a patent publication. I But still, I took one example. This is a granted patent in 2021. I took it because I was talking about Italian nationality. Is as you can see, is a system to monitoring analyzing the body language, which is one of the biometric character. And then this system, depending on the way you move your hand, recognize whether you are Italian and what is your emotion. In this, there are all these examples. The second one is about supporter of two teams in the center, in the center figure, and the system is checking whether there is a possibility of a fight between the supporters. The third one is about on the first line is about people watching video and with a remote system, you can see the reaction or the way of these people, whether they are happy, they are bored, even the pattern say stupid movement, etc., or expression. In order to decide whether the video is interesting or not, what they are watching is mentioned in the patent application, can be used in a video conference like we are doing today. So to see whether people are attentive or not, whether the instructor or the speaker like myself is convey interesting information or not. On the bottom you have a system checking whether in a hospital or in to see people if retirement house specifically if people are active or are unconscious, like people sitting there in order to intervene. People to check in the center whether they are performing well during an interview and coaching. And the last one is about people in a restaurant and checking whether somebody is impatient and so checking the emotion of these people and maybe intervene to calm down, etc. So the interesting thing is here, there are systems which are open, so in public environment, systems which are private, and this is also something as which you have to pay attention when you to decide whether there is a system high risk or prohibited, but will be too long to talk here. Quickly mention the AI Act talks about ethics, while as probably you've seen at the beginning, the EPC, the European Patent Convention, talk about morals rights. So again, here is something at least my age, 50 years ago, maybe the two words were interchangeable. Today it seems, even though some dictionary today still consider interchangeable, ethics more about external rules, moral are more about personal principle. And this might be something we see in the patent system, because we don't know what how the European Patent Office and the other patent system will respond to the European AI Act. So, and I copy again here the Article 53 of EPC. We have to see whether, as we did, as EPO did in the past, about the biotech directive, so the EPO, the European Union published the biotech directive about the human cloning, etc. And the EPO, the European Patent Office, reacted. We had to see whether EPO will do something similar also to EU AI Act. Nevertheless, you had to pay attention if you file a new patent, and you had to check whether your patent falls or not in these categories of in the four categories I mentioned at the beginning. And in fact, there is the EU AI Act specify what is called the Fundamental Rights Impact Assessment, will be published in future, will be also published template, formulaire, helping you to decide whether your patent application or your invention falls in, and then you have to check whether you can get a patent. The very last point is GDPR, so the General Data Protection Rights is especially concerning facial recognition. You have to be careful the image you put in your patent application, as I show here. So those are real images I took from patent publication. The person who is, and then you can see even there are children, picture in from publishing image publishing in these patent documents, they may ask you to they may ask to be removed. So so you have to be careful also when you draft a patent application in this situation. So I hope I presented the hurdles you had to overcome when you you file a patent application in especially in facial recognition or in biometric recognition. So patentability, EU AI Act, and GDPR, so are the things you have to take into consideration when you do that. And I finish here. Thank you, sorry for being long.
Thank you, Domenico. Thank you very much, very interesting. Again, feel free to type your questions or raise your virtual hand. We'll get back to the questions in after the third speaker. So our third speaker is Andrea Peronace. Andrea is a European patent attorney based in Rome, but since last year, since 2023, he has also been appointed as a technically qualified judge of the European Patent Court, that, as you know, is the new court of the European Union that was created with jurisdictions for all the patents concerning the 17 European countries that decided to join the Union. Andrea has a master in physics and also a PhD in physical chemistry. And in the past, he has advised the European Commission in matter of counterfeiting, anti-counterfeiting actions. And he has been in the working group of experts that curated the European Patent Practice Committee with special reference to the ICT and generally and general computer implemented inventions. And he also serves as a court expert before the Civil Court of Rome. And as a patent attorney, he also has a broad experience not only of patents, but also of copyrights and other IP means. Andrea, please.
Thank you, Chiara. Thank you to Politecnico di Milano, and thank you to the other speakers and the audience for being attending today. So just a quick disclaimer, what I'm going to present is not the official position of the European Patent Office, European Patent Institute, or the European Unified Patent Court. So it's only my point of view, my opinion. So let's start with inventorship for AI. So what are the requirements for getting a grant on AI patent application? In order to draft a proper patent application, starting from what the guidelines say, one has to specify first the kind and examples of training data, the AI model, the technical purpose of the AI, the specific AI you are trying to patent, the kind and examples of outputs, and the tests in general of effectiveness of the trained AI. So once you have this information, you can draft your patent application and with good chance to get the grant. So, but in order to get this information, you have to make investments. So in order to set up an AI from scratch and get this information, one must invest on devising a proper AI model, collecting training data, not every data, but quality data, which is also structured, and training and testing the AI. So according to some data scientists, the collection of data amounts to around 80% of the investment. So it's a very important part of the investment. So let's speak about ownership and inventorship in this case. The ownership should follow, in my view, the investments. So if the investments is done by humans, the ownership should be assigned to humans, as it is, in fact. And inventorship should follow inventive step. In order to have inventive step, one has to choose the data. One has to tell the technical purpose and set the technical purpose of the AI. And one has to devise the model. And these are actions done by human beings who also bear liability for that. And therefore, in my view, inventorship should be assigned to human beings. What if an AI will become an actual inventor? So up to now, AI functions are done with the so-called skills. A skill is a trained AI in a specific context. So Alexa has 5,000 skills today, and there is no abduction. What is abduction? You already know deduction and induction in mathematics. Abduction is the process by which you come up with an hypothesis, and then you test it. And abduction is a very fundamental logical process identified by Peirce. It's part of the full meaning of the word invention. So abduction accounts for changing between contexts, between skills, therefore. And in this case, if you had an abduction process in AI, if you had a general intelligence made by a machine, which is not yet done, both inventor and patent attorney could be substituted by an AI. But without a general AI, as it is today, and in my view, it's very unlikely that we will have in the coming years a general intelligence machine. And AI can still be seen as a tool rather than an invention machine. And a patent attorney is still needed to bridge a gap between the invention and the legal protection. So placing things in context would always need a human being who is responsible for the original idea and the way the AI was chosen and trained. Now we illustrate a case anticipated by Jean-Marc, because Stephen Taylor is an owner of a patent family claiming a food container and devices and methods for attracting enhanced attention. He has a patent family in many countries. He maintains that he is not the inventor of the patent family because the invention is the result of an elaboration by a trained AI, which he called the DABUS, which is an acronym for device for the autonomous bootstrapping of unified sentience. The various patent offices around the world responded to his naming of Debus as an inventor in various ways, and the case went to Supreme High Courts in various countries. So what are the facts here? Because the case is closed, and in all the countries except South Africa, it was decided that inventorship is a question of law, and the current law only allows to name natural persons as inventors. In South Africa, it's different. The inventorship was assigned to Debus, yes, but only before an administrative body, the patent office, and the case went not to an high court. So we have a different application of law in this case. What are the issues here? If an AI were to be named as an inventor, what would be the status of the owner of the machine upon which the artificial intelligence software runs? The developer of the artificial intelligence software, the owner of the copyright in its source code, the person who collects and inputs the data used by the artificial intelligence to develop its output. So we have, we cannot separate the AI from the human beings working with the AI in order for the AI to be effective. Other issues is, should the standard of inventive step be recalibrated? And here I have to tell you some words of explanation, because normally the inventive step is a requirement for the grant of a patent and is evaluated with reference to the skilled person. A skilled person is a person with average knowledge in the field of the invention. And it's a fictitious figure, it's a fictitious person. And it's always the same. It's someone who is, has no inventive skills, but knows quite a lot in the sector. So if an AI were to be named as inventor, the skilled person should be replaced logically by an AI. But assigning rights to AI is far more problematic than not. Because of what we have seen up to now. And if an AI were to be were to substitute the skilled person, then the AI should be updated. And how often? Every year, every month? And who is responsible for the AI? The European Patent Office? So it is far more problematic than not. Now, I want to say something about enforcement of AI patents. For the time being, we don't have the problem of general AI artificial intelligence, but we have the problem of enforcing the AI patents already granted AI as a tool. So we, in order to defend our patents and the products thereof coming from the patent, we have to show evidence before court. What is the standard of proof? We have to get access to the decompiled infringing AI, because the AI is most of the time a black box. A general mathematical formula without understanding what are the steps made by the AI. And so we have to get access to the compiled AI to see the AI model. But if the AI is not exactly within the scope of protection of the claim, the words of a claim of a patent, in a patent, then there is this doctrine of equivalence that allows the court to decide on infringement also on the basis of equivalence. So it's not literally infringing the patent, but is equivalent to what is written in the patent. So the equivalence can be made or can be taught between two black box AIs, so two AIs that both are unintelligible, or between a transparent model, which is a classical algorithm with a flowchart, and a black box model with the same purpose. Can a black box AI to be used to design around, that is, to avoid infringement of a patent? This is something that is asked on the internet, but nobody has responded as yet. I try to deepen the question rather than to give an answer. Supposed to have a classical transparent algorithm that you know now what it is, supposed to wanting to design around, Would an AI trained on the data obtained by the transparent algorithm be infringing? So you take the data from the transparent algorithm by using it because it's transparent, it's published in a patent, and you train an AI, and so you make something different. And is this infringing the patent or not? Would it be patentable, the AI trained in such a way as an alternative solution to the same problem? Would the other way around be possible, from an AI to a transparent model, to a transparent algorithm? This is also kind of possible because there are distillation algorithms which can translate the black box into a transparent algorithm, which is not exactly the same as the AI, but it looks like the AI, it has a very large superposition to the AI. And so this is another way to design around. And before court, we have to evaluate this. For the time being, there are no cases before court on this matter, but I think that that will be at a certain point in time. So if the answer is yes, how would an equivalence test look like? The triple test, which is an international test for equivalence, and the requirements are the same function of the AI in this case, the same result, final result, what you obtain, an image or a recognition, facial recognition or whatever, and the way you do it by the AI. The triple test then would fail the substantially the same means, because in that case, the transparent algorithm would be replaced by the AI, which is a different means. Or should we look at the way as substantially same input-output data and leave out the black box, because the data, after all, amount to the most part of the thing? These are questions. Of course, I don't have the answer, but I want to summarize the situation of the AI and patents in this table, which I called AI Patent in Futurology. On the left hand, we have a column. We have what is realistic, what is to be expected in coming years. And on the right hand column, we have real futurology and maybe science fiction. Let's start from AI-aided invention. These are inventions made by with the AI as a tool. And so we have problem of personality for the inventorship, for example, problem of copyright when you write the code, and licensing. So who should license, who owns the rights to licensing? And we have also assessment of AI equivalence, black box, as we have seen, formula that is transparent algorithms, and distillation algorithms that can transform AI into a transparent model and design around. Then on the side of science fiction, which I call science fiction because it's very far from coming a reality, from coming true, AI generated inventions, that is invention machine, which are devised to invent they do this as a tool, they invent all the time, and we'll have problems of ownership, because who owns the inventions, the many inventions so generated? We have the problems of filing, because maybe they can file online directly without the need of a patent attorney. And in that case, we'll be flooded by invention, thousands and thousands and millions of inventions, because these machines would invent all the time. And therefore, in order to see what are real invention, that is something that can be applied in reality, we have to raise the bar of reduction to practice. We have to ask to write in the patent application what has been the reduction to practice, the tests in the lab, and the real application of the invention. And finally, We have also AI perform padded assessment, that is infringement made by AI. That is, the AI goes on the internet and find the infringement of a patent, be it an AI patent or a classical mechanics or biotechnological patent. And also prior art, the AI can spot the prior art on the internet or can create a flood the internet by fake prior art. And then we have to decide what is fake prior art, what is real prior art. And then finally, there is also an economic evaluation of the patent made by an AI, which is, by the way, interesting. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Andrea. So in a minute, we will open the question and answers to the public. So I see that you are posting your questions in the chat. Feel free to do so or raise your virtual hand and you'll be able to speak. But while we collect a few more questions, I would like to pose a couple on my own. And specifically, some of the things that you touched upon are related to how do you train the algorithms. And clearly, we have started to understand algorithms that are not just good or bad or perfect in and of themselves. It's mostly that they are as good as the training that they have received. So one way in which competition will go about will really be about the training. And so I would like to raise these questions to both Jean-Marc and Domenico. So specifically to Jean-Marc, I would like to ask, do you think it is legitimate to actually use copyrighted material that has been disclosed publicly? Think about the New York Times. Clearly, there is a very famous case going on. To train an algorithm, is that a legitimate use? We know it's copyrighted, but on the other hand, the type of use that it's being made by training algorithms is somehow new or different with respect to what we have before. And on that respect also, Domenico, what about covering the training material? So is there a way to actually allow or think about a way to cover the training rather than the result of what an algorithm does, please. And I'll just recommend to give brief questions. I know they're very broad answers, but try to do your best.
I'll do my best to be short. Well, I could have a two-pronged answer, sorry, to this question. First, a positive law. One, we've got a regulation in Europe that states indeed that we have exceptions to copyright exclusive rights related to access to data. And even though you can be protected by copyright, if you're a research institution, if your intent is non-commercial, well, indeed, there's actually no way to prevent people, research institutions, for scientific purposes, to use these data to do things with them, to build models, to train large language model, foundation models, sorry. So that's one thing. But also a second aspect that says, indeed, if you're not a public institution with research intent, if your commercial if your purpose is commercial, then you should ask indeed for permission if the authors had opted out from this exception. So there's a sort of a balanced approach here, but is it working? No. In practice, I believe this opt-out option granted to the copyrights rights holders is not effective indeed for technical reasons, for legal reasons, very, very complicated topic. I won't go there, but it's not effective. I believe indeed that if you reproduce data and if you don't compete at the end with the rights holder, there should be a sort of a more balanced approach. Looking at competition law, looking at parasitism would be better, in my view, better ways to measure this sort of new equilibrium and in a sense also promote a responsible use of the trained model. So we want to engage in a responsible innovation process, indeed, protecting the rights holders, we need them, but at the same time, we don't want to stifle creativity in the field where we need data desperately, good data in quantity, but quality one as well. So we are there as well. I believe in a sense, we should have a more balanced view using maybe concept from the fair use approach in the US. We don't have them in Europe, but maybe we need to look out there as well in that respect. So, Domenico, I don't know if you need to...
thank you. Well, okay. In fact, Well, I would like to start from what Andrea just said at the beginning. So 80% or something like that is the effort when you design an AI system. 80% when you design a system is about data training, acquiring training data, curing data, etc. Yes, this is well, okay, there are some something like that in the literature. I have also my own experience at the European Patent Office when we design the team there design the team in fact they put in place 10 years ago a design system, for instance, for machine translation or image recognition. In fact, this requires an enormous effort in acquiring data, classify the data, and normally the model, the algorithm, etc., is something is maybe open source. You don't have to develop yourself. So really, this is I would say something striking, at least for me. And I discussed this also at TPO, whether because of the importance of the training data should be part of a patent application, because this will create also an issue for the patent system or the patent office, because if you start sending to a patent office all terabyte of data you have used to train your machine, okay, well, you basically you are seeing how many patent application or patent publication are around. So basically, you are going to kill the IT system at the office, because probably we don't have the resources to receive too big a patent application. And more or less, Andrea already has already reply. What we in a patent application, you don't need to have to include all the picture, all data you have used for training is enough if you just put you explain what type of data you have used. So I use a picture to train. I use for instance, machine translation. You use the pair, so you have a document in Chinese, a document in English, and then you use a sentence here, a sentence there, the corresponding, the pair. So this, the methodology, you explain what type of data you use. You don't have to include the data. Nevertheless, the patent office, the patent examiner is happy because we don't have to read all this data, but the person, the company who have collected the data still need to protect that. And the UK Patent Office, what I can say, made an inquiry to whether it was useful to have kind of registration or a public repository of training data, but nothing happened. So basically what is left is the sui generis database protection. So, okay, as Jean-Marc said, at the moment we are a little bit in a situation where I don't see a big way to protect the data, so on, and still this is personally is something is missing because as I said, investment mainly is in collecting data, so not given the answer probably, but still is open. But
thank you, Domenico. I also wanted to ask something to Andrea, taking advantage of the fact that he is also a judge at the new Unified Patent Court. And so it is my understanding that a lot of the things that we have been discussing, for example, the EU Act that decides, that states a bar for what should be considered ethical or moral, will raise a lot of case laws. Where in practice the judges will have to take decisions regarding what is legitimate and what is not legitimate. And right now we have a dual system in Europe because 17 countries have currently joined the Unified Patent Court, whereas others are going to do it or they have decided to somehow opt out or stay out for the moment. And so I'm curious, what do you think will happen in this case? Which court or group of experts will be mostly influential in deciding regarding the case laws?
Thank you. I respond, of course, in the field of patents. The European Patent Office is an independent entity, so it's not controlled by the European Commission, nor it has to abide by union law. On the very contrary, the UPC has to abide by union law. And the UPC, through Article 65, which refers to Article 138 and 39 EPC, which in turn refer to Article 53, is tied to decide, is bound to decide on patentability and exception to patentability. Therefore, the UPC has to decide also on all the public and morality about AI inventions, patented AI inventions, because patented or patent application on AI inventions. So we will be judging this as soon as we have someone pleading for this and claiming that a patent is not moral, is contrary to order public. Of course, we have no case law on that, but since we have to abide by union law, we will be bound in some way. We don't know how, but we will be bound to the Act. Contrary to the EPC and the EPO, because the EPO has also other countries such as Turkey, for example, which is not in the EU, and therefore it has to find the balance between the needs of the various countries. But we could be bound more tightly to the AI Act.
That's very interesting, and I want to take one of the questions from the chat from Michele Fattori for Domenico. So, based on your knowledge, have any invention already been rejected at the European Patent Office for on grounds of the issues of Article 53?
Well, okay. Honestly, I don't know. I saw the question. I maybe Jean-Marc has. Insight on that. I don't know that. And also the question goes on saying about GDPR. By the way, this was 3 years ago. I asked myself to the data protection officer exactly the same question about what I mentioned, the patent publication with picture of children, or if somebody can, or what is going to do the EPO in such a case, will remove the picture, will blur the picture. So the answer is no, I don't know. There is no answer at the moment, but since today we mention the Dr. Thaler test, maybe, and since I'm talking to university and also Jean-Marc, maybe this is a good test, the Politecnico, the SAP, they could file a patent application clearly challenging the office and becoming famous. trying really to see whether or to see the reaction of the patent of the system. Okay, well, I went, if I may say, if I may complete this point, I didn't have time. Okay, well, maybe if you remember the slide, I mentioned of this real patent granted in 2021, so before the EU AI Act was in place, even, I don't know whether they were already at that time, or probably yes, some draft, etc. Was interesting reading the patent application, the example, and the claims, because the claim is very, the granted claim is very, let's say, generic in the sense it doesn't mention nationality, it doesn't say where the data are, whether the system is public or not. But if you read the example of this patent application, so at a certain moment I mentioned there is a restaurant or a cafeteria where people, or supermarket where people are getting nervous, there is a real-time camera checking the emotion of the people. This will be forbidden in the EU AI Act today. It's not in the claim, it's only in the description. So the question is how we or the examiner will use Article 69, interpreting the claim in the light of the description, whether we will consider what is in the description or not. So other example, for instance, the coaching session is explicitly said in the patent that this is on laptop, other are in the cloud. So is, as you said, complication. So AI Act add the complication, then you have really to pay attention how you formulate your claim, your patent application, because just putting this little definition will make ill maybe your patent if EPO or UPC will adopt the UAI Act or the ethical or the morality principle. And this is the question, which we don't know yet the answer.
Okay, so we should start reaching the end of this seminar, but I would like to read some of the questions and give the last words to the two speakers that have, to the two people in the audience that have raised their hands. So my suggestion is that I'll ask now the speakers to read the questions for them in the chat, and then provide a brief answer. And in the meantime, I would like to ask Ruggero Barzon to switch on the mic and give their brief questions. And then the second person would be Charlotte Turnbull. Yes, please.
I have a question for Professor Jean-Marc Del Torno regarding companion AI. So for if I'm creating if I'm creating a book where everything is original, it's my invention, but I'm supported with an AI companion, if it helps me backwards, so if it probably helps me rewrite what I already written in my text to make it more enjoyable, I think there are no problems. But what if this AI suggests me also how to continue with my story, even though the characters and the setting is mine, for example, which is the level to which is not anymore my own creation.
Right. I mean, it's a fascinating question. We don't know yet. I mean, you have to make a difference between the idea proposing, for example, a thread, and you would be following, writing a story, putting your own, I wouldn't say the word style, we have to be very careful with that word, but your own imprint on the output. You're making choices on the particular way you are expressing those sentences. It's a matter of degree. It will be judged on a case-by-case basis. There's absolutely no uniform answer to provide you a sort of a firm guideline on where to put the threshold of originality there. It does not, of course, prevent you from being an author, provided there is enough room for maneuvering. If you just follow and copy and paste the output from ChatGPT, probably not. I mean, the courts are inclined to say no, because they want to be protective of that sort of a realm of originality where humans are the centerpiece, okay? That's really the essential part of the issue. But of course, at the same time, as you saw by at least the court in Italy, but the same in the US, actually, we are very clear on the fact that we don't want to prevent new forms of creativity, including the one you propose, you know, a prompt generating an idea that you would follow up, you would follow the thread on your own. That's it. There's an essential element that will be important in the future is the matter of proof. How are you going to convince the courts and, you know, your opposing party that you indeed were making all those choices? There may be plenty of business models working on that. They are actually trying to archive and making your creative process auditable, so that indeed we can refer back to the steps where you injected those modicum, those little pieces of creativity, little choices, little nudges, including using the, you know, the assistance of an AI model. So you can be an author. That's actually, you can be an author with ChatGPT, absolutely no problem. If you just rely on the copy and pasting on the output, probably not. But if you add to it, it could be, actually.
Charlotte.
Hi, thank you. I'm Charlotte. I'm a solicitor in London. So thank you for inviting me to join today. And thank you to the speakers for your views on this. It's really interesting. My question might actually be quite a long one, so I'm not sure we're going to have time to answer it. But I wanted to ask you if you think that the EU AI Act is adequate, and if not, what you would suggest should be changed.
Who's taking the lead? Who's jumping in the deep waters.
Do we want to hear Andrea first? So Andrea, you can put yourself in trouble right away if you want.
I'm not an expert of the AI Act. We are as judges, we are having training, internal training, but not on this topic yet, because the AI Act is not still in force. So I would rather turn the question to Domenico, who's
about. Well, interesting. Well, as you know, I already said at the very beginning, I read the corrigendum of the documentation is almost 500 pages. I went through the definition. I think even though they say simple, or is meant to facilitate the implementation of AI system. Well, okay, I have my concern, let's say, no doubt concern. Even I just I was reading the American one. Okay, well, in fact, the executive order. I said the White House even now mentioned the use of AI for biotechnology research, so which is even a step further. So I don't know whether it's difficult to say what is wrong there, etc. Still, I want to say something. Because a lot of our answer, which are very annoying, I think, for the engineers, is it depends, we don't know, etc. The point is, as you know, in IP law is always it depends the answer, so which is really annoying, even myself after 33 years in the patent office. So the point is, going back to the data, because I debated with the patent law department And this applies also to EU Act, etc. So really, I would like to be more progressist. What I see, the European Patent Office is very conservative, and there is a reason. And I had a fight internally when I was in the office about this conservatorism approach. Is because we cannot change the patent law, etc., because this will be will create even more mess in the system. So I was surprised to see the changes. First, in EU AI Act, they change basically after 1 month and 1 week. They change. There were already a corrigendum. The version in December is different, etc. So you see, there is it is a difficult topic. I mean, is a complex. Go back to my slide. Probably the slide I like more. I did is the beginning. Complex. I forgot now. So the is a complex system AI. So, and then the complication of analyzing a complex system. So, yeah, probably, I don't know, probably the future will, okay, the patent futurology as AI futurology, as Andrea said, will tell us where to go. But it's a complex matter, and there are a lot of complications, yeah. And even okay, I just said the slide because still I see people use moral and ethic at the same time. Ethic, so there is overlap in my slide, okay, and meaning there are areas which are wrong or right at the same time. So religion is abortion. So abortion is a problem in Italy. For obvious reason, Vatican Catholic country, but France now wants to put this as ethical fundamental rights. So you see, the putting all pieces together is complicated. So is adequate? I don't know. Probably not.
Yeah. For the sake of time, I think we can try to tackle a few more very short answers, but we should aim at closing in 5 minutes. I think we're already about 10 minutes after the schedule. So let me ask the speakers if they want to address some of their questions, perhaps selectively, before we close. So I'll give a few minutes to each of the three speakers. Thank you.
I'll start, if you don't mind. I like the last Matteo Marcozzi says, in short, the answers are expected as are, we'll see, maybe, could be, indeed is right. But I think we're also providing some guidance in that sort of realm of uncertainty. Technology is moving super fast, too fast to follow. But indeed, with the EU AI Act, as you know, imperfect as it is, it's not as plenty of loopholes there and there, and we could talk for a long time about those. But it's a first step, and I see that as an iterative process where we engage the community of engineers, you, and the community of lawyers, the people in charge, the politicians, the elected members of parliament, and so forth, in sort of an exercise of collective intelligence. And it's a real push, that technology that interrogates the subject matter of law. And that's quite interesting. We saw that with Domenico and Andrea, the notion of inventorship, the notion of what is inventive, what is permitted in the construct of inventions, but also in the artistic world, is being sort of, you know, tickled, I would say, by the advent of new technology. I find it quite interesting. It's a work in progress, indeed. Plenty of fuzziness in that sphere at the moment, but I think it makes it quite interesting also. So thanks, Matteo, for the heads up. No, cool, cool. Not a critique. I didn't take it as a criticism at all. I think it's really right, actually. Totally right. Yeah.
Andrea, also feel free to provide a final remark.
Yes, yes. Thank you. I have already responded to one very good remark from the audience in the chat. I want only to say that instead of giving answers now, which is very difficult because things are changing quite a lot, we should deepen the questions, break down the questions to more meaningful questions, not too general, and we try to respond to those questions. And this is something that the human being is very capable of, and the AI is not capable of. So we should think as human beings and deepen the questions in order to get the answer whenever they are key to our social life. Thank you.
Domenico.
Well, okay, well, I already said, yes, okay, it's work in progress. Even though we consider just the EU AI Act, as I said, consider also the what the UK is doing, we should also consider what the US is doing, and I think they are even, as I mentioned, the biotechnology, which is not part, AI on biotechnology. So there are, there is more to come, I mean, and then we have to follow and adapt. And as Andrea said, really, yes, we have to go in depth. And maybe the patent I mentioned can be a good point to use this patent to check, for instance, whether we'll pass the high risk, for instance, high risk criteria, etc. So this could be an example because there are a lot of things there, even though it's a simple document, simple example, they are really trying to challenge the system. And it's too soon to say whether we are there, and so we have to wait and keep working, exchanging idea as we are doing today in this webinar. And thank you again for inviting me and us, I guess.
Well, on that, I also wish to thank very much the three speakers. I think the discussion has been extremely interesting and full of insights to me. And we stated it since the beginning, it's very difficult to have any very good or final answer. We are still really starting a very, very intricate and interesting debate that taps on a lot of different things. But I think what we did today is also quite essential to try to forge this debate in a way that is also the broadest possible and the more accepted and debugged that it's possible. So again, thank you everyone, and also to the audience and those that have registered to the event will receive an email that includes the link to a recording. Thank you again to the speakers, and we look forward to read more.
Thank you, Chiara.
Thank you. Thank you.
Goodbye.
Thank you.